Should we go through the hole under the horse fence or climb the rail over the bridle path?
Well, I guess the horse fence would be a little safer.
Well, but the bridle path puts us right out next to the squab shack.
Oh, okay.
What's wrong? You're acting all skittish. Don't worry, I've been stealing birds for a living since before I could trot. By the way, you look unbelievably beautiful tonight. You're practically glowing. Maybe it's the lighting. I've been
in this town so long. What is mise-en-scene? It means, quite literally, staging of the scene. It is a term adapted from the theater, and referred to everything the audience would see and hear on stage. Once the term applied to film, it referred to everything the audience sees, hears, and experiences while viewing it. You could say that mise-en-scene is the most basic concept in film. So then how does a professional filmmaker like Wes Anderson use this element in Rushmore? Let's start with the color scheme. Even the most casual Wes Anderson fan may notice that something is unique about his choice in color scheme. That's right, he uses an abundance of red and yellow in his composition. Red and yellow are warm colors. They stimulate the viewer, creating some excitement or intensity. This excitement permeates throughout his films, and coupled with some quick cutting or fast movement, can leave the viewer breathless with anticipation of what happens next. Is there any other meaning behind the color besides what's on the surface? Probably not. Wes Anderson seems to have chosen the colors not for any other reason than that is what he likes. It sets a tone for his films and distinguishes his movies from any other. Something else very interesting is Anderson's use of framing. He seems to be a fan of framing the object of the shot dead center in the frame, placing an incredible importance on that object and only that object. He keeps the main action of the shot in the center of the frame. It gives Rushmore and his other films a sense of peace and balance. The shots put the viewer in an almost sense of awe. It gives the viewer an unusual perspective not seen in many modern films and demands a perfectionist look. Some would say that Wes Anderson was partially inspired by Stanley Kubrick's use of one-point perspective. Others have said that this makes his films a bit on the boring side. Compared to the sweeping camera movements and quick cuts of a film like Avatar, Anderson's Rushmore feels quiet, reserved, and methodical. While yes, he does have his fair share of action going on in his films, the camera is usually slightly pulled back from the main part of the action and makes the viewer feel more like the audience in a theater production. Anderson's use of shadows is also interesting. In this scene, the use of darkness on Max obscures his face and gives his current state of mind a mysterious feeling. We know he's upset, but we don't know to what extent. Once we see his face in full with the lighting change and the camera angle change, we see that Max is in a state of pure anguish and hatred. Though it is never specifically said outright, we infer this subconsciously through the masterful use of mise-en-scene. This later is confirmed to us by the escalating war between Max and Herman Bloom. A scene very similar to this one, but in an entirely different context, is this scene from the Grand Budapest Hotel. In this scene, the main character, Zero, tells a minor character the story of his long-lost love, Agatha. At this point in the story, we don't know much about her, only that the older Zero doesn't want to speak of her and that she is not around in his old age. We are led to believe that something bad happens to her, and this idea is supported through the mise-en-scene. In the scene here, as Zero reaches the point in the story where he has to bring up Agatha, the lighting from the above turns dark, and when the camera pans, we see that he is upset. In the ensuing close-up, the dark covering his face is illuminated, and we can see his anguish. We instantly know that something truly awful has happened to Agatha, and leaves his audience guessing what it is. While I don't want to spoil everything, this assumption leads to an amazing bait and switch with Agatha's presumed death and the actual death of a minor character. Next, we will look at how slow motion can affect mise-en-scene. In this scene in Rushmore, we see Max slowly walking from the right in the frame and the stage, and turn towards the camera to look at the boy who punched him earlier. With a triumphant look on his face, we see Max's cocky smugness in a single shot. The slow motion gives a huge emphasis and importance on Max, or at the very least, what he perceives to be his immense importance. Through the scene's mise-en-scene, we are viewing this scene from his perspective. Speaking of perspectives, how does changing the camera view to the first-person perspective change the atmosphere of the shot? Generally, the first-person perspective accentuates the action of the scene instead of a medium shot from the profile view, which would lessen the impact. The first-person view is exciting, riveting, and allows for a change of pace from Wes Anderson's normally slower movement on screen. One aspect of mise-en-scene which normally gets ignored is sound. While certain schools of thought consider mise-en-scene to be the sum of only the visual elements on screen, for the purpose of playing devil's advocate, we will assume the sound plays a part indeed. With Wes Anderson and Rushmore in particular, the soundtrack chosen for the film is almost more important than the score itself. The soundtrack for Rushmore uses the music of many lesser-known British artists from the 60s. The musicians, according to the film's music supervisor, Randall Poster, would wear coats and ties on the cover of their records, but the music was so aggressive and rebellious. I think that corresponded to Max Fisher because he was this kid who, underneath it all, was looking to break through. He later went on to say that the theme of a character running out of time in the world is a running theme in their films. M. Gustav from the Grand Budapest Hotel is another example of this theme. It is astounding that Anderson and his music supervisor can portray so much with something so simple as a musical choice. Anderson and Poster also use the soundtrack to their advantage in The Fantastic Mr. Fox. One of the two songs in particular that come to mind was the use of the Beach Boys' Hero and Villains in the beginning of the film. It's a change of pace among the softer score by Alexander Desplat. Near the end of the film, we get a wonderful scene of the main cast dancing to a gleeful tune by Bolly Fuller 4. The camera goes to a long shot of the cast and continues to pull back until they are just dots in the screen. The use of music in Fantastic Mr. Fox is from the same era as the music from Rushmore, but the use of the American side of the era cements the tone of the film to be far more lighthearted and less rebellious. At the end of Rushmore, we get to see what is probably the best use of soundtrack in Anderson's entire filmography. Ooh La La by The Faces is the perfect song for the closing scene. We see that Max is finally happy with his life, surrounded by his dear friends and family, dancing with the ex-love of his life, Miss Cross, and enjoying the success of his theatrical masterpiece. We see the use of slow motion in this scene, allowing the audience to fully take in the scene unfolding before them. Centered in the frame is Miss Cross and Max, facing each other in a seemingly loving dance. Finishing this off is the closing of the blue curtain, thus ending the theatrical performance of the characters. All in all, it is very obvious that Wes Anderson and his crew are very aware of mise-en-scene and how it affects the viewer. Him and his crew have made us uncomfortable. They made us cry. But most importantly, they made us laugh.
Breathe me, lost me, fierce, said he.
Holy shit, you got him!